Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is West Wind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. I'm very happy to be here today with Dr. Sandip Patel, who is Associate Professor in Medical Oncology and Hematology at the UC San Diego Moores Cancer Center. So thank you so much for joining.
Thanks for having me, Jack, and it's always good seeing you. You know, one of the beauties of social media is we get to interact, but it's even better to catch up face-to-face, so nice talking with you.
Yeah, it's too bad that even though we're in Southern California, it's not that easy to run into each other at the grocery stores. Yeah. We're just far enough away, it's pretty inconvenient, but...
Yeah, if we got caught in traffic, it may take the same amount as a transcontinental flight if we left at the wrong time, so...
That's true. Okay, so let's... go all the way back and to your childhood. Where did you grow up? And at that time, were you or your family planning to have you go into medicine? I mean, when did that all come about?
Yeah, and so as we're recording this in Texas, I grew up actually in Houston, Texas, in a small suburb that's now grown quite large called Sugar Land. And my family's still out there. My parents still live there. My sister's out there. And, you know, in terms of what I wanted to do when I was a kid, I, like everyone else, went through the motions of, you know, firefighter and then astronaut, you know, being from Houston, of course. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, in high school, that's really when I found my passion was, you know, biology, sciences, and I was able to do some volunteering where I got to take care of patients. And, you know, for someone who focuses on books, right, your whole academic career from elementary school, middle school, high school, to finally apply that knowledge kind of outside and just see that people, you know, these physicians are able to actually take this very basic knowledge and kind of translate in ways that help people's lives. That really captivated me at a very early age. And I was able to have some visits to the Texas Medical Center in Houston. I actually did a lot of rotations at some of the hospitals in the Baylor College of Medicine system, which is actually where I ended up doing my medical school many years later. But the idea that, you know, we could take, you know, this very basic body of knowledge in biology, chemistry, and just translate into things that actually matter to people. I think that was a eureka moment for me, really kind of, you know, probably my freshman or sophomore year of high school. And that's really what kind of pushed me into wanting to go into medicine because I loved science, but I wanted to do something practical and something meaningful and something interactive with it. And I think medicine has been a good opportunity for that for me.
And did your parents strongly encourage that? Or were they in medicine? Are they? What do they do?
Yeah, so my dad is an engineer, or was an electrical engineer before he retired, and my mom worked for the school district. And, you know, in our culture, wanting to go into medicine is smiled upon. So, you know, they were happy to hear that was something that I was interested in. And then in terms of oncology, that took a little longer, but apparently may still be a little early compared to some. And so I decided I wanted to do medical oncology, I think my senior year in high school.
Wow, that is early.
The reason for that is actually, you know, doing these rotations in the summer, I was actually able to rotate at MD Anderson, which is in Houston as well.
Of course.
And I got to meet some people who basically became really lifelong mentors. And just the idea that I was able to take what I was doing all year in school and see that we could take that knowledge and help people who are dealing with a very grave illness. You know, we see these patients every day and try to make a positive impact. I think that really transformed me. And so, you know, we talk a lot about these summer outreach programs, right? And we're often asked to volunteer for them. And I always say yes, because I don't know if I'd still be here if I hadn't had these multiple opportunities to interact with people who really want to make the world a better place and really show kind of the finer aspects of medicine and finer aspects of really just how to talk to patients, how to talk to each other, how to interact. And I think medical oncology in particular requires a toolkit of not only understanding, you know, statistics and biology, but understanding people, because we're dealing with people who are dealing with their disease at the hardest point of their lives. And we're trying to help these people through this very tough time, or maybe for whatever time they may have left with us. And not only them, but the family and the social unit that takes care of them. It's a very unique specialty. And it's something that I really kind of saw the difference when I was doing all these rotations, even as early as high school, where I didn't know anything, right, about medicine or medical school or what a soap note was or anything like that. And so it's funny how much you can learn from the social aspect of things. And I think that's really what initially and continues to attract me to medical oncology.
Well, it's interesting, though, that medical oncology has changed a lot since I went into it, which preceded you. But, you know, in the last 10 or 20 years, I think it's always been a unique specialty, but the opportunity to make big gains has been remarkably more gratifying, I think, in the last 10 or 15 years than it was 20 or more years ago. Of course, there was always things we could do, but I think there was more flailing. And now, you know, especially with what you're doing, so much more personalized medicine, but the whole field of molecular oncology, precision medicine, changing how we do what we do, it's a different field.
Absolutely. And I think the idea that we can take what we understand about cancer kind of more broadly, you know, in terms of TCGA and all these databases, but actually do the same tests for the most part for individual patients to help drive their therapy, I think is something that if you'd asked people 15, 20 years ago, would we be here? I'm not sure they would think so, because the technology really has accelerated and allowed us to do things in clinic. Now, sometimes it leads you astray and leads you down a path in which you give a patient a therapy, or some people are enticed to give a therapy that may not be the patient's best therapy. Meaning, we have complex data. And it's interesting that we went from a time in which we were trying to decide which chemotherapy made the most sense, and maybe there's four or five of these to pick from, and maybe we pick based on side effects, to now we get these really complex molecular reports, right, that survey 500, 1,000, maybe even exomes. And we're in a big data field now, where we have to take this very complex data and try to figure out what makes the most sense for a given patient in terms of their therapy. And I think that's probably a wrinkle to the field that maybe a lot of us necessarily didn't expect. We expected the researchers maybe to have to deal with complex genomic data, but actually having to bridge the digital divide from this massive data set, these reports that are often not optimally curated for a human-to-human type interaction because they're designed from a digital-to-digital type interaction, I think is something that I think we all struggle with and we've talked about before.
Yeah, we'll come back to that. But I'd like to go back to your training, the earlier days. You speak Spanish, I think, fluently. And
un poco.
Qué bueno. So where did that come about? Was that from, you know, early in school? Did you pick it up out of necessity at Baylor? Yeah. And then I know you went to Southern California after that. So where did you decide you needed it, and where have you honed that?
And so living in Texas, living in California, these are binational communities. And so the ability to speak Spanish is very helpful. It helps you interact. It helps you live in a world and also appreciate kind of my place in the world, right? That, you know, there are people from different cultures, different backgrounds. And while many of us speak English, not all of us do. And I think where this really crystallized to me is when I was a medical student, we have a county hospital called Bentaub Hospital, big county hospital, takes care of a lot of patients, a lot of indigent patients, great mission, great group of doctors. And if you couldn't speak Spanish well, it was very hard to take care of patients, especially in an emergency situation. And the other thing is, you know, we have translators and interpreters and things like that. And increasingly, a lot of this is actually digital, right? You have like an iPad, you do the translation through the iPad, things like that. But what I realized is patients wanted to interact with someone. They'd rather take my kind of high school level Spanish rather than kind of a professional level interpreter who's, you know, visualized on an iPad and is sitting, you know, somewhere else, because it is a specialty that we have close connections with people. And this is actually kind of the tragedy with the EMR, right? In the sense that it's just another digital divider between us and the patient, because we have to do something else that's not person to person, which is kind of what brought me into the field in the first place, seeing these very kind of personal interactions. And so the ability, even in my clinic today, you know, now I'm in San Diego, which is also another binational community, I'll ask patients what they prefer. And they'll always go with me talking. And I tell them, listen, my Spanish will not be as good as this interpreter, but they'll always pick the face-to-face. And listen, most of our Spanish-speaking patients, that their English is good enough that you can finally meet halfway, but we're able to speak Spanish in a meaningful way. And it goes back to the point that I think in medical oncology, it's a field that has a lot of high IQ individuals, but there's a very big EQ component to this, an emotional quotient, our ability to relate to people. And I think language is a key component of that. And I think, you know, what you do in social media, Jack, is a way of communicating, right, to people, a broad audience in which the language that's different is oncology, right? It's effectively a different dialect. Mm-hmm. And so I think Spanish is kind of another flavor of that.
No, that is interesting. I think there is an incredible value and skill set of being able to translate complex medical jargon, the molecular oncology, into understandable bits, you know, giving analogies, things like that. And it's, I think, good to simplify or oversimplify, but make it accessible to people. But I agree with you that, I mean, it's for me as somebody who has struggled to learn passable Spanish, even to understand, let alone to speak, to me, I'm just realizing, yeah, that's limiting and I'd really like to get better at that. Did you grow up with Hindi in the home or any, you know, other languages from your family?
Yeah, and so we spoke Gujarati, which is a dialect for the state my parents are from, and a little bit of Hindi. I did, you know, the conventional elementary school kind of schooling, though we all ended up speaking English in the household. Okay. Anyway.
When did your parents come? Were they here a long, long time?
They moved here in the late 70s. Okay. And so I have a younger sister who's 4 years younger than me. And so she also speaks Spanish. And so the interesting thing is we probably speak English as our first language. Then me and my sister probably on a given day speak more Spanish than even our native language. And then we speak our native language probably third, because that's how we communicate with grandma. Mm-hmm. and so on.
But you probably don't have that much occasion to use that outside, you know, professionally.
No. I think, you know, for those who've been to an Indian wedding, that's when you kind of go all in on Hindi or even Sanskrit. And then it's basically when you start teaching your kids kind of the language, which I think it's important. And so my own children, they're kind of in a trinational or lingual state in which they're learning English, our native Indian dialect, and Spanish. And they kind of are just mixing it all together, which is a bit of the way I grew up, but it's much more fluent and much earlier age for them. And it's really nice to watch the kids be able to communicate with anybody. And I think that's one of the things I really enjoy about this and kind of what you do, Jack, is the ability to communicate and communicate with as many people as possible, because we deal with a very hard field with medical oncology and cancer. And so the ability to actually take, as you say, this complex information and translate it, whether into just normal people English, right, as opposed to medical oncologist jargon, or Spanish or Hindi or Gujarati or, you know, another level English. I think that ability to communicate is something I really cherish, because these are hard problems and we need a lot of people with a lot of good ideas to do that. And that involves being able to communicate, which we were able to do in person and now increasingly with social media.
Yeah. You say our language. Is your wife of Indian background as well?
Yes, she's Indian, though from a different part of India, Tamil Nadu. And so, you know, in India, it kind of like, you know, we'll be in Spain later this year for World Lung or ESMO or both. The regions have their own flavor, mm-hmm. Both in terms of culture, dialect. And so my wife being from a slightly different part, there's actually different languages. And right. In fact, the language derivation's different. Ours, Gujarati, is a little more European in origin. Hers is actually more Dravidian in origin. And so we actually, sometimes if we're speaking to the kids, won't actually quite understand exactly what we're saying unless it's a word that kind of flowed into a more common language.
Excellent. Is she in medicine as well?
Yeah, she's actually the successful doctor in the family. Okay. She's a dermatologist in private practice in San Diego. So
I'm sure there's a waiting list for her.
She's very good, very much in demand, and ought to be.
Excellent. Yeah. So you went to UCLA for your internship and residency, and now you're in San Diego. So was Southern California always a potentially appealing place? What was it that drew you there potentially for a very long time now?
So I met my wife in the ICU at UCLA. She was an intern. I was a resident, and that's actually where we met. She's born and raised in Southern California.
Excellent.
And, you know, Jack, as you've kind of moved here, once you get in Southern California, there's some nice things. And so she didn't have to pull too hard to want to keep us in Southern California.
You did your fellowship at Duke. And I don't know if it's a sensitive subject, but I knew Anil Podi years ago when he was working with Dr. Joseph Nevin's work published in the New England Journal. Exciting stuff. And of course, that ended badly with being discredited and retracted. He had a big academic fall from grace, but that couldn't have been too long before you went there. So was that ever spoken of, or was it just not covered, or what kind of effect did it have on the program and your training?
Yeah, great question. So it did predate me. It affected some of the fellows, actually, who were in his lab and who had to find other mentors, but they're all very successful now in academia, doing well. I think it was definitely talked about, and it was definitely like a warning, right, in terms of research fraud, you know, what the consequences of that were, and then how do you structure institutions, because many of those changes had to happen after this was all uncovered to avoid these kinds of things from happening again. And I think, you know, anytime something like that happens or you hear about that, you know, I always try to take a lesson from it. And the lesson, I think, is not simply don't do research fraud. That's a very simple lesson we should all know. The lesson really comes down to, in that scenario, what I learned is that non-financial conflicts of interest can have as much or even more power than financial conflicts of interest, right? So financial conflicts of interest, everyone puts up their slide and they all too quickly advance through it. But it's, you know, enumerated, it's measurable, it's something everyone sees, it's something that can be audited. But non-financial conflicts of interest where you fall too much in love with your own work, right? And then you start playing with the data yourself instead of working with
statisticians. Yeah. You know, just the opportunity to have high impact work that gets published in the New England Journal of Medicine comes with, you know, a tidal wave of publicity and accolades and, you know, raises your stature incredibly.
Yeah. It's an Icarus, like a research Icarus syndrome, right? In the sense that the higher you go, the more pressure you feel to go higher. But then, you know, I think I wasn't there when it happened, and I don't know, you know, him personally, but, you know, you hear about it starts with like one cutting corner or one Excel cell that's changed and then multiple. And then no one comes out saying I'm committing research fraud to publish in the New England Journal of Medicine. It's death by a thousand cuts, I think. And so I think it definitely had an impact in terms of how to structure a program to avoid that kind of thing happening again. But I think in many creative industries and many scientific industries, it's so hard to distinguish the nature of people who are just very enamored with what they're doing versus people who are just so drinking their own Kool-Aid that they'll do anything to prove it. And I think that distinction and how to create systems to protect against that are key, because this ultimately affects patients.
Well, I think that, you know, this is something that is not that isolated. I think this was an egregious event, but I don't think many outside onlookers think, oh, that could never happen here.
Yeah.
But you know, rather that this is probably more common than we know.
Sadly.
But I think that another key issue is kind of like Theranos. Anytime you're reviewing data, we want to take that at face value.
Yeah.
But,
yeah,
you know, how skeptical should we be versus, you know, trust? And certainly it's unfortunate when it undermines the trust in academic medicine. But so you moved back to San Diego. How much of an appeal, or what is the feel of UC San Diego and Moores in terms of precision medicine? Because my sense is that that is a real leading light, entire ethos there.
Yeah, I think, so the University of California, San Diego, part of my attraction to it, having trained at UCLA, is there is a mission to the University of California that relates to research, taking care of patients, and taking care of effectively multinational communities in very diverse cities. That's very attractive. Next generation sequencing, many of the companies that are involved in that are located in San Diego and are spin-outs, right? And so it's an ethos that comes from a lot of the research, actually, that was done to develop some of these technologies and collaborations therein. I think precision medicine overall, in terms of what's done at UCSD, really relates to utilization of next-generation sequencing technologies to try to match patients to appropriate therapy, either in the standard of care setting or within the context of a clinical trial. And so for those who are familiar with the TAPER study, for example, or MATCH, those are the kinds of studies that are available. And you know, as we're looking into the next generation of targeted therapy studies like combo MATCH through the NCI, you know, how can we best find patients who have a specific molecular aberration who may actually benefit from not only the approach of sequencing, but actually a downstream matching of targeted therapy that can hopefully positively affect their outcome. These are the kinds of research projects that are specifically ongoing at UCSD, but increasingly really nationally and through the NIH and cooperative groups as well.
We'll continue our discussion with Dr. Sandip Patel in the next episode. Thanks so much for joining me today for this Westwind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com or looking for Westwind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.